Tonight I'm wetting my whistle with Good Neighbor Brewing Company's Especial Amber Lager. It is Mexican style, according to the can. They describe it as a Mexican style amber lager brewed with Galena hops and a combination of caramel and roasted malts. Yeah, and the guy at the brewery, when I picked this up, suggested that it was maltier than you would expect from Mexican style. And you can see that from the color as well. Well, that is interesting. I might have to try that one again. So, today I'm going to do a teardown of this thing that a buddy at work gave me. This is called a Wink Hub. And what it is, it's an Internet of Things sort of connector units. And as far as I understand it, its job is to basically talk over multiple different protocols to various Internet of Things devices in your house and sort of connect them to each other and to your Wi-Fi and whatever else. This particular one, though, when he bought it several years ago, it came with the promise of one price, lifetime service, no extra fees, all the rest of that good stuff. It cost him, I think, about $80 or something several years ago. And he said it worked quite well with the various devices that he's got in his house. But then in the spring of this year, the company said, oh, wait a minute, that ain't profitable. Okay, now all you people that we promised free service forever, yeah, screw you. You got to pay us $5 a month, otherwise all your stuff's going to stop working. And they just shut them off. I have never been a fan of Internet of Things companies, especially when they're cloud-based. And that is why. But I don't care about the software. I am here to see what this hardware is all about. Easy disassembly. Four screws and off she comes. That's just all plastic. Looks like there's two little light pipes there. They go to the front, one to there and one to there. Okay. So that means there's a couple of LEDs on this board. Is that held to the back with anything other than friction? Come out. Yeah, there we go. Oh, there's a couple of weights in the bottom there, I guess, to make it not fall over. Okay, that makes sense. What do we have on the board here? Back of the board's pretty easy. On the back here, we have the barrel jack, 12 volts DC unregulated. We have a system reset button, which is accessible through a little hole in the back of the cabinet there. We have a bunch of capacitors that are on the back of one of these RF cans. And we have a position for an SPI flash chip, which is not populated. Looks like their board was made by a company called Flextronics. And that's it on the back. Oh, I guess there's an antenna etched in up there too. Okay. On the front, this gets a little bit more interesting. Up here we have a section called 2.4 gigahertz Wi-Fi and Bluetooth. Over here we have 433 megahertz Lutron. So those are a couple of the protocols that it talks. There is an antenna. There's an antenna over there. There is an RGB 5050 LED. We have a JTAG header. What else do we have just labeled on here? An Ethernet port footprint, which is not populated. Down the bottom here, we have Zigbee, 2.4 gigahertz, and it's got a JTAG as well. Over here, we have 433 megahertz KIDI, or KIDA. I've heard it pronounced both ways, and it doesn't make sense. That doesn't say duh on the end of it to me. And it's got its antenna over there. And then we have a couple of RF cans here. We have a dual UART. Another JTAG connector for that stuff. So it seems like it's basically got a chipset for each of the different protocols that it handles. Oh yeah, here's a 915 meg system over here that I didn't notice earlier for some reason. ZWSPI. Oh, Z-Wave or Z-Wave for the Americans. Okay, so that's the various protocols, I guess. Should we peel up those RF cans and see what's under them? Of course we should. Sometimes these RF can lids are soldered down. These guys didn't do that, so that's awful nice of them. The smaller one down here just has one chip, an inductor, and a bunch of capacitors. So the inductor and capacitors are probably some sort of a tuned circuit, I would think. See if we can see what that chip is around those bars. I was mistaken. That's not a little RF circuit. This is a synchronous step-down converter. It runs anywhere from 4 to 17 volts input. Its output's adjustable between 0.8 and 12 volts. And it operates at either 340 or 800 kilohertz. So that's why it's in a little cage to keep it from interfering with all the other fancy stuff surrounding it. Okay. And that's probably how it's set up. And there's various component selections you can make with these inductors, capacitors, and resistors. You can set the voltage to any of these options. So that's interesting. Usually I expect RF cans like those to be used to keep RF in and to not have it interfere with the rest of the circuit. This is kind of the other way around. It's keeping the power supply's frequencies in to prevent it from interfering with all the RF stuff. So this blatantly labeled NAND flash chip here is, oh, there's the part number there. We'll go and take a look, see what that is. No surprise, it is in fact NAND flash. This being the L01G1 version, it's the 1 gig. And it runs on 3.3 volts. So that gives us some clues about what that power supply, that little buck converter is doing. Just looking at some of these other chips, and I think I found the brains of the operation. Over here in the corner where the RF section is labeled 433 megahertz Lutron, and there's a little register switch. Does that have a button on the front panel? No, it doesn't. Huh, so that must be just for programming, because that's not user serviceable. Anyway, this is an STM32L100. So that will probably be the main controls, I'm guessing. Unless there's some other weirdness going on in here. Oh, there's a little PIC microcontroller, a PIC16F, what is that, 883? Okay, so that is over in this corner here with the other 433 meg system. So it's probably using this guy for its RF, I would think, whatever he is. CC11DL. That's not familiar. I have to go and look that guy up. I was wrong. It's CC110L. And that's a sub 1 gigahertz wireless transceiver. Okay. It can run in 300 to 348 or 387 to 464 or 779 to 928 meg. And that makes sense because on the board it's labeled as doing 433 in this case. What else we got? This one over here, 915 meg wave, it calls itself according to the label on there. The SPI calls it the ZW SPI. That's probably the Z wave. Again, just a compact little two-chip solution there. The main one is this guy here, SD3502A. Yep, that's what it is. It is a general purpose Z-Wave microcontroller. It's designed for all these kind of IoT sort of things over here. And it runs between 865 and 926 megahertz, which is what it's doing here, 915. That makes sense.
And what do we have down here in Zigbee corner? That's a 2.4 gigahertz. So that's in the same unlicensed spectrum as Wi-Fi operates up in the other corner there. Which explains why that antenna is pretty much the same shape and size as this antenna for the Wi-Fi up in that corner. And that Zigbee chip calls itself EM357. And again, it has a little helper beside it, which is probably some kind of RAM program memory or something like that, I would think. It's got a little crystal for its reference right there. Let's go take a look at that chip quickly.
So the EM357 is, as we thought, a high-performance integrated Zigbee system on a chip. Among the things in it, it's got a 32-bit ARM Cortex-M3,
It's got a 2.4 gigahertz radio. It's got some flash in it, probably 192. It promises that it coexists nicely with Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, which makes perfect sense because those are also on this board. It's got a bunch of GPIO on it as well, and an ADC and a whole bunch of other things too. It can do way more than it's probably doing on this board.
Remember before when I erroneously said that this STM32 might be the brains of the operation? It isn't. It's this guy here. This guy with the impossibly huge part number, assisted by its little friend right beside it.
So this makes a lot more sense for being in charge of everything. This is a full-on microprocessor. And here is some of the specs. You can pause it for a second if you want. I'm not going to read all of this because there's a lot going on here. It's got an RTC. It's got USB hosting. It can host cellular connectivity devices. It can host all of these other different types of devices directly interfacing with it. It's got a battery charging and battery management circuitry built into it. It's got 16 ADCs. It's got all kinds of stuff going on inside it, all powered by this little 454 megahertz clocked ARM core in it. Wow. And its assistant sitting underneath that RF can right beside it is a piece of DDR2 RAM. It's this version here, 8 meg with by 16 by 4 banks. That's pretty much a computer in there. This is getting way out of microcontroller space.
There is a lot of very capable hardware on this board, and all of it originally for something like $80 or thereabouts. Unfortunately, it's saddled with a company that decided to change their mind on their on how they're going to treat their customers after selling these to their customers, and that managed to piss off an awful lot of people, including my buddy at work who bought this thing and literally tossed it in the trash, thinking that, you know, just complete bait and switch, scam artist, unhappy. So he's gone with a different solution. As for me, that kind of business practices just reinforces my skepticism about the whole cloud-based IoT world in general. I've never been a big fan of it because I just like to have control over the devices that are physically attached to my home. That's just me, though. Should we look at this power supply? It's not very heavy. It says it is 12 volts at 1 amp output, and this device says that it only needs half an amp unregulated. Where did it say that? It said that somewhere. That's where it said it. 12 volts unregulated. So I don't expect that this is a super high quality one. Like I say, it weighs almost nothing, but since we're here, might as well crack into it. What do you think? Yeah, this video is not very long. Is that gonna work? No.
Maybe. No, that's.
There we go. That was easy. What do we have here? We have some stupidly low current wires coming in. We have what appears to be a fuse because it's marked F. We have four diodes in a bridge rectifier configuration in there. Yeah, those ones there. We have a capacitor and probably a choke L1 there. So this is just a classic switching power supply. There is the switching chip under that blob of celastic, filtering capacitor, transformer with really loose tape on the outside of it, optocoupler for feedback, little transistor driving it, or possibly a voltage reference. Hello?
Yeah, it's a voltage reference. Okay, adjustable anywhere from 2.5 to 36 or 18 volts.
So that guy is setting the voltage threshold for the output side, and when it crosses that, then it activates the optocoupler, which tells this chip that it's reached its voltage.
There is the diode rectifying the output of the transformer, and two filtering capacitors, and a class Y capacitor. This is just a classic little cheap, lightweight, claims to be 1 amp power supply. If I didn't have, 50 cheap 12 volt power supplies kicking around here already, I might be sad that I was a little assertive getting into it. But I suppose this thing could probably be used again. Just with a little bit of care to put it back together. There you go, like new. You'd never know what I was even into it. I bet it even still works. Oh yeah, there we go. 12 volts pretty much bang on the nose. Awesome. Well, that was a fun little diversion. I wasn't expecting to find actually so many powerful little chips inside there. But I guess for what they had it doing, I guess that sort of makes sense. This company is still in business. They make a newer product than this. Now at least they're not baiting and switching. They still have a monthly service fee on it. But now finally they're telling you up front about it. So if you buy it, then you're not getting caught off guard and them changing their mind on you. I will put a link to this company's Wikipedia page in the description in case you're curious. But yeah, and I hope I didn't get too ranty on the whole IoT bullshit thing, but sometimes that just happens. Thanks for watching. Questions and comments down below as usual. Thanks to my buddy for giving us this thing to tear into and take a look at. It is an interesting device from a hardware standpoint anyway. I'll talk to you later.